Good afternoon and welcome to today's presentation, Roadway Construction Defects, Hydroplaning and Other Dangerous Conditions. In today's webinar, Mr. Rice will discuss types of pavement defects, case studies, the players in roadway construction projects, and engineering report provenance. To give you a little background about our presenter, Richard Rice, he is experienced with civil engineering, traffic accident reconstruction, structural engineering, and construction and building inspection. He has written several published articles and has given several lectures on forensic engineering. Mr. Rice is a registered professional engineer and registered building inspector. He has two OSHA certifications and is on the National Council of Examiners for Engineering and Surveying. Attendees who require a passcode, the word for today is road. During the Q&A session, we will ask that you enter this passcode into the Q&A widget for CLE reporting purposes. The Q&A is located to the left of your screen. Please remember that if you're applying for CLE credit, you must log on to your computer as yourself and stay for the full 60 minutes. You are also required to complete the survey at the end of the program. Tomorrow morning, we'll send out an email with a link to the archive recording of the webinar. The slides can be downloaded from the resource list to the left of your screen. Thank you all for attending today, and Richard, the presentation is now turned over to you.
Thank you, Ms. Emily. Again, my name is Richard Rice, and I want to thank you all for attending this webinar. I've given this webinar in other formats and other locations, and it's always been well received. And I have to tell you that if I use acronyms or phrases that you do not understand, please type them in. I will answer every question that you ask. So let us begin. Roadway construction defects, hydroplaning and other dangerous conditions, or the other title of this could be, whose doors should you be knocking on when you get a file involving a roadway accident? I have found that most adjusters and attorneys, they might get a roadway incident, but they're really not sure just who all the players are. This will be in two parts. We will talk about the types, or many parts, excuse me, four, types of asphalt pavement defects, case studies, there's several of those, and just who are the players. And what things do you ask for when you get one of these cases? In part four, bonus material. Types of pavement defects. You have roadway rutting, which can cause hydroplaning. You have improper roadway geometry, say the curvature of the road may not be proper, horizontal. The horizontal curvature and the vertical curvature. You might have an improper shoulder height. Heights of roads change when you add overlays, and the contractor must account for that. And that's where you also have shoulder edge drop-off problems. And then improper maintenance during construction. While the road is owned by the contractor, it's very important that that contractor maintain that road in a safe manner during construction. And those types of pavement defects are just to name a few. Causes of roadway rutting. Basically, we're talking about asphalt pavements, and any of you who have ever done baking knows that once one thing is wrong with the cake mix, the whole thing is messed up. So in asphalt, you can have too much liquid asphalt, you could have too little. You can have overcompaction, or you can have undercompaction. Overvibration, well, this is for concrete. And then also you have improper aggregate, both asphalt and concrete. Now, an aggregate means rock, the stone. It can anywhere from sand, which is roughly what is collected by the number 200 sieve. That's a little inside baseball. Or it could be inch and a half, two-inch stone. And then you have the improper placement temperature. That's very important in an asphalt pavement. So if one thing is wrong, the whole cake mix is wrong. This is rutting in the wheel track. This happens a lot in rural areas where you have logging roads or just heavy machinery. You get, as the arrow shows here in this slide, you get rutting in the road, and this is where water collects to cause hydroplaning. Now, the bottom arrow in this slide, that is where the water is collecting in the wheel rut. The The top arrow, that is where the car ended up, where a young woman was killed. She hit this section. Rule of thumb is anything quarter of inch of water at 40 miles an hour, you can have hydroplaning. But there are, but that depends on the type of tire you might be using or how quickly the water is being, you know, whisked off the road. There are all kinds of variables. But the rule of thumb is anything over 40 miles per hour and a quarter inch of water, you could have hydroplaning. Excuse me. You could have improper aggregate, the stones. You see the quarter and see the stones next to it. See how rounded they are? You cannot use rounded aggregate stones in an asphalt mix or in a concrete mix for that matter. There are codes and standards, federal codes and standards, that require so many fractured surfaces in the rock, and that could cause rutting. Here's a temporary fix for a rutting situation. You see here where the local DOT, could have been city, county, or state, put in a patch to keep the water from collecting in the rut. Now, one of the most important things you can do when you have a roadway case and you suspect that the road was contributory to the accident, you must test the road. And that's what this gentleman is, well, he's not doing the testing. He is actually collecting the cores. If you have a asphalt rutting situation, you need to find out whether it was too much, too little asphalt, those things that I talked about before. Then the only way to do that is to physically go out and take cores in the road. Now, that can be difficult sometimes. I have had state DOTs refuse to let me go out and take cores, and others that had no problem with me taking cores and putting back a cold mix. But this gentleman here, in this particular case here, this gentleman is taking cores at a location where there was a young woman hydroplaned and was killed. This is near Birmingham, Alabama. Well, after you take the cores, bring them to the lab and make sure that they're labeled before you get them there. But what they'll do, you might have multiple layers. About halfway up on this picture to the left, you see the one that says B2. You'll notice three separate layers in this asphalt. Normally, you only have two, a base course asphalt and then a surface course. That's a term of art here that we use in the southeastern United States. But you could have multiple surface courses depending on, you know, the history of the road. So you have to cut those out, and each one has to be has to be tested. Now, here's a case study. This actually happened. The uncalibrated professor. I was working on a rutting hydroplaning case. I was hired to evaluate the roadway and the asphalt pavement. I went out and took the cores or had them taken. I was with them just so that there was a proper chain of evidence. I always go with where the core taker goes, and he hands me the cores, and I'm the one that takes them to the lab. Anyway, I take them to a lab that is certified. They have certifications on the equipment that they use, calibrations and certifications, and certifications on the people that actually perform the tests through the Asphalt Institute. Labs send their people to the Asphalt Institute to have them learn the latest in asphalt testing. Well, I get the test back, and I find that the cause of the rutting is in the asphalt mix. Well, the defense in this case, this was a local contractor. They hire a high-dollar university professor at the state university, and they have a very, very large lab, and they graduate many civil engineers, civil structural engineers, very respected. I was quite impressed in their choice. He takes these asphalt cores, and he has them tested by his university students at the university lab. Kind of cuts the cost. Well, the professor finds no fault with the asphalt mix after he's done. Well, we get him into deposition, and the professor confesses that his students are not certified asphalt technicians. They're grad students at best. In addition, now this is the biggie, the measuring and testing equipment used to test the asphalt cores were not calibrated. And we're talking everything weights to national standards. As a result, this university professor of high esteem had his test results thrown out by the judge. The professor was quite upset. It's very difficult to see in this, but this is the damming of the roadway. The road actually slopes from right to left, and in the far lane over there, next to the shoulder, you might see these two. You see these two joints, and you see the darkened pavement on the right side in that far lane. Well, between that joint and the joint on the left, there's actually that joint on the left prevents water. Is preventing the water from draining down the road, and as it was designed to do. As a result, water was kept in this location and caused the hydroplaning that killed two sisters, 19 and 17 years old, and their dog. This was on an interstate. I believe it was either Mississippi or Alabama. Improper roadway geometry. I talked about that earlier. Everyone is familiar with a horizontal curve. Well, vertical curves, you know, they kind of give you that funny feeling in your stomach as you go over, if you go over them too fast. Well, in this particular case, not only do you have a horizontal curve, as you see here, going to the left, but also the road slopes to the left, and you have a vertical curve in this location. As a result, the tires lost their traction, and a young woman was killed. Two types of improper shoulder height. It's either too high from the shoulder or the shoulder's too high for the road. And then that's what we have here, where water is collected on the road. Now, this may not be a major thoroughfare, but I have seen this many times where local DOTs allow the shoulders to grow over the years to allow water to collect. It's not going through the grass anymore. It's actually being dammed up by the soil, and that can be a very significant problem. This is what proper shoulder height should look like. The water, you see the major road on the right, water drains to the left, off the shoulder, off the road, onto the shoulder, and then from the shoulder into the grass. This is ideal. This is not ideal. Most DOTs require no more than a 2-inch drop-off from the road surface to the shoulder. This is because people will drive off the road. They do all the time, but that does not mean they should die. What should happen is that as they're turning their wheel, they should be able to remount the road because, like I say, people go off the road all the time. And when you have generally more than 2 inches, what happens is that, say, the right side goes off onto the shoulder, you try to remount the road, you turn, you keep turning, and then all of a sudden you grab the road, you lose control of your vehicle, and you'll flip. I'll show you more about that here in a minute. Remember, 2 inches is the general rule. Some states allow 3 during construction, but the general rule is 2 inches. Here's another shoulder edge drop-off case I worked on. Somewhat difficult to see, but you see the mud and how that shoulder on the left side, it just drops off. And this caused a dump truck to roll over into the woods because of the shoulder condition. During construction, this is what it should look like. you're going to have during the construction of or the overlay of your road, usually on existing roads, the local DOT, they'll want to instead of ripping out the road and doing it again, they will allow an overlay, and that's what they've done here. Normally, they're put in 1 to 2 inch increments. So when you add 2 inches to an already 2 inch drop off, you have a four inch drop off that can be a very bad situation. So what you do is you build a taper, and that's what you see here underneath that stick tape in that level. You see it's about a 4-to-1 slope where if someone goes off the road during construction, and it happens all the time, they can easily mount back onto the road without any damage or injury. The second case study, a long way down. The contractor in this particular case, he placed an asphalt overlay on an existing road. An ambulance drops off an 8-inch shoulder created by that contractor, an unprotected shoulder. What I mean by unprotected, there were no cones, no warnings, nothing, no signage, alerting the ambulance driver that there was a drop-off. Well, the ambulance attempts to remount the pavement. Well, let's back up a little bit. The ambulance went off the shoulder in this particular case because a deer jumped out, and he wanted to miss the deer, so he goes off the road. He misses the deer, and he attempts now to mount the pavement. He's turning to the left. He's turning to the left. He keeps turning. In this particular case, it was a woman. She keeps turning and turning, and then finally the wheel grabs. The ambulance is shot into the oncoming traffic, the lane, and almost hits a pickup truck. Well, she turns hard to the right to try to miss this pickup truck, and she rolls over. In the back of the ambulance, you had an unbelted doctor who was assisting her patient. As a result of this rollover, the doctor becomes a quadriplegic. There were two experts. I was one of them. We show improper, a dangerous roadway condition, and an improper asphalt mix by the contractor. In this particular case, which was kind of rare that it all went all the way to trial, the insurance company, the defense's insurance company, they offered no expert, and they ignored all offers from the plaintiff to settle. And at one time, they wanted to settle for limits, but I'll let you guys, some of you know what I'm talking about there. So, but as a result, no one accepted anything, so it went to trial. It came back with a $10 million verdict for the plaintiff. Again, the way a shoulder should look like at the edge of a road. You may not have any more asphalt, have an asphalt shoulder, but you have your soil lower than the asphalt. This is important to find. Improper maintenance during construction. Now what you see here is a sweeper. I worked a case several years ago where an issue was whether a sweeper like this was used during construction. I may go back to this slide. In this particular case, on this road, actual road, you had a 19-year-old. He was going 60, 70 miles an hour. Great surprise there. But what happened is that as he entered this curve, he hits a bunch of gravel, and the curve is to the right. Well, he goes off on the left side of the road because of the gravel. Pardon my allergies. Well, the 19-year-old boy is killed. His estate sues the contractor because the road was under construction at the time, or an overlay. They sue the contractor and say that this contractor did not sweep the road when they left at 5 o'clock that afternoon. The incident occurred about 11 o'clock at night. So the plaintiffs in this case, this was a defense case I worked, the plaintiffs in this case claimed that the contractor did not sweep the road at 5 o'clock before they left, and by contract they were required to. But what came out in deposition, as I was being deposed, the plaintiff's attorney was talking about the sweeping and the duties of the contractor, and that there was gravel located on the road at 11 o'clock at night, and there was no doubt about it, and it was gravel that the 19-year-old had not placed there. We were able to determine that during the investigation. But what came out of my deposition, and I don't think the plaintiff's attorney appreciated, that also part of this contract is that the contractor had to sweep the road in the morning, regardless of whether there was an accident or not. So every day at 5 o'clock they sweep, but every day but the next morning, 7 o'clock in the morning, they would have to sweep again because, as I said before, people drive off roads all the time for whatever reason, and they kick gravel onto the road. So the plaintiffs in this case could not establish exactly when that gravel was placed because it came out in deposition that the contractor had to sweep in the morning because of gravel normally on the road. Now, let's not forget the signage. Signage is probably one of the most ignored causes of roadway incidents. Not only the signage placement, signage size, but also the quality of the signage can be an issue. Are there any questions at this time?
And could all the attendees please type the passcode into the Q&A? Our first question is, can an individual sue the city or state DOT for an improper maintained road where someone is killed or injured?
That depends. In Alabama, you can. In Georgia, it's very difficult. It really depends on the state. Even the federal level, that can be very difficult. If you'll remember, here in Atlanta, there was a busload of baseball players coming south through town, and they were in the high occupancy vehicle lane, and the driver mistook a left exit for the interstate, and basically went airborne at the top of the bridge and killed many of those boys. Well, that particular HOV lane was designed by the feds, and they were involved in that lawsuit. Now, I didn't get involved because of conflicts, but the feds were involved with that lawsuit. If anything, you want to get them involved because they'll have the names of all the players involved. Next question.
Okay, the next question is, can a built cross slope change over the life of a road, for example, through compaction?
I've seen it where one lane did, not the whole road, but maybe one lane, and that's rare. And then you have a serious settlement problem going on if that's the case. Next question.
What is the deepest shoulder height you have seen?
That one case I talked about, 8 inches. That's pretty bad, and that's what caused the doctor to become a quadriplegic when the ambulance rolled over.
And what does the roadway look like when it has too much asphalt?
You'll see blotches. You might see blotches too in southern states or southwestern, southeastern states where the heat gets into the asphalt and brings up blobs of the bitumen, term of art. But if it has too much asphalt, you're definitely going to get rutting, and then you'll see blotches, black blotches on the road. But then again, you have to confirm it with testing.
And what procedures are used to conduct the site inspection soon after an accident or before?
What procedures? Was that the question?
Yes.
Well, there are ASTMs, as you might imagine, for everything. There are ASTMs for testing asphalt when taking cores. As a forensic engineer, you have to abide by those codes and standards. When you take the asphalt, there has to be a chain of custody. There is an ASTM standard for that as well. All those must be adhered to. And when doing an asphalt case, after you bring them to the lab, there are ASTMs or even state codes and standards with regards to testing, which are very similar, as you might imagine, to the national codes and standards. There might be some slight differences, but you just need to use whatever the contractor used when the pavement was placed. Next question.
And so if you run off the road, is it best to slow down first before trying to remount the road?
Always. I've been teaching my daughters that constantly ever since they were 15 years old, and they're sick of it, I'm sure, but I don't care. When you run off a road, you slow down and ease yourself back on. That's the safest thing to do.
Does the quality of paving materials vary state to state overall?
Very good question. Here in the Atlanta area, we're very blessed with granite, lots of granite, good aggregates, good stone. Whereas I know in Birmingham, you have a lot of dolomite, and they have to bring in a lot of aggregate, and that affects the cost. And sometimes local contractors, to save money, will use a softer, less quality aggregate in order to make their asphalt. Now, there are federal standards and state standards that have to be adhered to. And so generally speaking, no. When you go from state to state, you know, the Federal Highway Administration, the ASHTO, American Association of State and Highway Transportation Officials, ASHTO, their codes and standards regarding pavements, you know, they have to be adhered to nationwide. Next question.
Next question is there any standard for the drop-off down the center line while repaving is going on?
Good question. I'm going to say it's no more than 2 inches as well, and there has to be a taper built with that, if I remember correctly.
Next question is, are potholes a significant danger to motorists?
Oh, always. I mean, holes in the road are a bad thing. They have to be, they can almost be considered, and pardon the legal language, my sister's a JAG attorney, not a stationary hazard, but you lawyers can probably help me with that. But the local DOT, city, county, or state, whatever type of road it is, that must be fixed. And yes, it will cause accidents.
Okay, those are all the questions we have for now. We do have another Q&A at the end of the presentation, so please continue on.
I will. Thank you very much, Miss Emily. Now, remember what I talked about, signage. This is a case study. It was pretty tragic. You had a major intersection under construction. You had 16 lanes coming into this one intersection. We're talking two lanes each way plus passing lanes. I mean, it was, you know, turning lanes. It was serious. But at the time, and when you can, well, let me back up. Here you have, four lanes coming from each direction, and how wide, and each one of them 12 feet wide, so 4 times 12, 36, and plus the right-of-way, we're talking really wide coming in from each direction. Well, at the time of construction, only two lanes were open, and while this was going to be a signal stop intersection, at the time of the incident, it was an all-way stop. There were stop signs in each four of the directions. Now, here's an acronym, MUTCD, the Manual of Uniform Traffic Control Devices. It is the signage Bible for roadways, Manual of Uniform Traffic Control Devices. When you travel from state to state, even in Puerto Rico, you will find that the signs are pretty much the same and should be placed in the same place. The MUTCD, in this particular case regarding stop signs, requires that the stop signs be placed 6 to 12 feet from the travel lane. That means that as a driver comes up, just looks, eyes should go to the right and just see the stop sign. All right. The height was really an issue here. The contractor, in this particular case, by the way, had already was behind schedule, losing money hand over fist, was trying to save every chance possible. He places a dirty stop sign 21 feet from the travel lane. A young woman coming home from church, travels up this road the first time, and she does not see the stop sign, goes through the intersection, and hits a pickup truck and kills a five-year-old inside the vehicle. This was a tragedy. Well, I established that the signs were in the wrong place. The sign was in the wrong place. And not only that, but the reflectivity of the sign was wrong. It's a fairly new standard, and the equipment used to measure this is quite expensive, and I rented it for this particular case. But, the reflectivity of that particular stop sign was almost zero. It was garbage. Basically, they pulled the stop sign out of the garbage and put it on a piece of pipe and put it 21 feet away. So this young woman, she had no opportunity to see the sign. Okay, here we get into a little bit of inside baseball, roadway construction process. Now, I'm just going to hit the highlights here. Now, if you get one of these cases where there's a roadway construction going on, there are a lot of players and a lot of moving parts. So we'll just start at the top, planning and design of the proposed roadway. Someone prepares the construction plans and specifications. As part of those plans and specifications, it is required that someone prepare a quality control and quality assurance protocols for each. Now, the difference between QC and QA. Quality control is what the contractor does. Quality assurance is what the engineer or some representative of the owner does to make sure that the contractor did his job. And once the QA results come back, that is when the contractor gets paid. Okay, then let's back up a little bit. Now we're at the bid opening, and the most responsive roadway contractor is selected. That's not necessarily the lowest bidder. The most responsive could mean someone that actually has the experience on this type of project, depending on its size, and is in good standing, with the roadway community. Somebody that has recently been convicted of the some sort of collusion in the last several years may not be a responsive contractor, and they'll get kicked out of the bid. That's happened before. Once the contractor is selected, they're usually, it's not listed here, there are pre-construction meetings, so everyone's on the same page. And then the owner, in most cases, in, say, a large project, the state DOT, will provide a notice to proceed. That is a very proper document that tells the contractor the meters are running. You have, 180 days from this time forward to get the job done. Now you have the construction of the roadway. The asphalt, the subgrade gets placed. There's lots of compaction. You have lots of inspectors on site. Your QC and QA activities are going on. And here's your daily inspections of the contractor's activities. This could be performed by, say, the state DOT, or if it's a county government, they may not have the personnel, so they'll hire an engineering firm to do that. I've done that before. And you'll have material pay quantities, and somebody will keep up with the equipment used. And eventually the road will get done, the punch list gone through, and then the final document that means the meter's no longer running is your letter of acceptance. There's a lot more to it than what I just mentioned, but those are pretty much the highlights. We'll have a case. This is case study number 4. Dolomite and geometry don't mix. Dolomite is a type of stone. It's kind of like limestone. Limestone and dolomite are very similar. In this particular case, you had a 24-year-old driver traveling 40 miles per hour on a two-lane road. She loses control at a horizontal curve on a hill that is sloped to the outside of the curb, very similar to the picture I showed you earlier. She hits a tree and is killed. In addition to the improper roadway slope, asphalt testing indicates that the use of dolomite as an aggregate, as a stone in the asphalt mix, it was used. The use of dolomite was forbidden by the state DOT due to polishing and reduced friction of dolomite. Again, in this particular case, the insurance company did not hire an expert. I was the expert on the other side. I don't know why they didn't. But the case settles big for the plaintiff. I don't know what the number is. It's undisclosed. But as part of the settlement, that entire roadway, this was a road around a Galleria mall, not here in Atlanta, but a large mall. This was the circular road around it. All of that had to be taken up and replaced as part of the settlement on the, in this lawsuit. Who are the players in the roadway construction project? I recommend that everyone pay attention to this, because this is, these are the people who you're going to be contacting. We call them your potential responsible parties, and we call them PRPs. Who are your PRPs? In most construction projects, these are your players. Your Federal Highway Administration, your state DOT. You have your local, either county or city DOTs. You have private roadway designers and engineers. I've worked for several. You have the roadway general contractors. Many are my friends. And then you have the various subcontractors and vendors that these general contractors will hire. These folks might be providing the asphalt. They might be providing the guardrail or anything like that. Why is this particular PRP important to a roadway project? Well, you have your Federal Highway Administration. They're probably the most difficult to bring into a suit because they're so high up. But they may have provided federal funding, so they have a dog in this fight. They may have provided the QAQC guidance, how to do it, who should do it. So there again, they may be part of your suit, and they may have provided direct design guidance with regards to a particular intersection, or, and I know right after that incident I mentioned with the baseball players that died when they left an HOV lane, the Federal Highway Administration, they were all over that one, redesigning, coming up with better designs to keep people from going off on left-hand exit ramps thinking that they were still on the interstate. They were very involved with that. You have your State Department of Transportation. They were the designer of the interstate highway or the state route that might be your case. Sometimes they hire third-party engineering firms to do that. Usually considered the owner in contracts involving interstate highways and state routes. They develop the roadway construction specifications, also known as specs, the roadway specs. In Georgia, you have, I don't know what color is now, but each state pretty much has its own roadway specifications. They usually contract directly with the roadway contractor on interstate highways and state routes. And they normally, when there's state money involved, they provide inspection services. Also, they might be providing the laboratories. They have state laboratories. In Georgia, they do. Alabama, most other states, Texas, California, they have their own state labs to provide quality assurance. Excuse me. Your local county DOTs, usually considered the owner in contracts in their cities. They usually hire private engineering firms, so there's a paper trail there. And they usually hire out these engineering firms not only to do the design of the road, but also the construction management, you know, making sure that the letter to proceed is given and that the notice to proceed is given and the letter of acceptance is written later. And they provide inspection services. And, as I say, they perform inspection services on the roadway. They usually, these local DOTs, contract directly with the roadway contractor. And these folks usually rely on state laboratories to provide the quality assurance. So there's a paper trail there. You want to bring them in. Private roadway designers and engineers, I've worked for a few, they are hired by the owner sometimes to design the roadway. Sometimes, unless they do it themselves, hired by the owner, unless they do it themselves, to prepare the construction plans. Even the state DOT will hire private engineering firms because they do not have the staff on hand to do the design of a particular road, so they will hire out private engineering firms to do the work. I'm reading down here, these private engineering firms, they provide the management inspection services during construction. That's not very unusual, especially with the smaller counties and municipalities. And they're hired by these smaller owners to maintain change orders, addendums, and amendments to the construction plans to keep up with that. That can be tricky. And these private roadway designers, they contract directly with the owner. And we work, or I should say the private owner designers work, with state laboratories to provide quality assurance. However, private firms, engineering firms, are also hired sometimes by the contractor to provide the quality control. It's somewhat convoluted, but there again, what I'm telling you is not unusual. You just have to know where to look. And then you have the general contractors themselves. They usually contract directly with the owner. They contract with the owner to safely build the roadway as directed by the construction plans and specs. They contract with the owner to provide the quality control sometimes as directed by the construction plans and specs. Now, they contract with various subcontractors that will provide a specific service or specific material to the job. They work directly with the state and local DOTs or representatives. These general contractors usually own the area of the roadway construction until a letter of acceptance is issued by the owner. While the job is ongoing, the general contractor, quote unquote, owns the road, is responsible for it. And as you might imagine, the general contractor, the GC, generates much correspondence between owners and others. And then you have your various subcontractors, the asphalt suppliers. They contract directly with the general contractor. They provide materials and services that the GC doesn't provide. In a quality control role, they perform the tests. They could be a subcontractor to do that for the QC. And these various subcontractors, they have copies of the various material quantity tickets showing amounts used on a particular road. This is important when you're trying to figure out just was 4 inches supposed to be laid here, and the tickets only show 2.5 inches was laid. That might be the rock you have down the road. So it's always important to know who the subcontractors are to get all their paperwork. Now, what to have your client bring to you for your first meeting? So you get a case, and your client is, XYZ contracting, and you meet them for the first time. What do you ask them to bring? Regardless of where they are in the hierarchy, this is what you ask: the complete contract between the client, your client, and whoever hired them, the employee timesheets for the time spent on the subject project, all correspondence between your client, whoever that might be, and whoever hired your client, any formal drawing specifications, quantity sheets, napkins, yes, I've seen contracts written up on napkins, or anything given to your client to develop their bid. From these documents, you will prepare your list of potential responsible parties. Now, what to immediately ask for from a potential responsible party in your request for documents. This is long, and you're going to get copies of all this, but the thing is, you may not know what you're reading when you get your copies here. But something else to understand is that if you do not ask, I've done this a long time, if you do not ask these DOTs or these contractors exactly if you don't ask them exactly the right question in the right way that they understand it in this industry, they'll claim that they don't know what you're talking about and you'll never get that document. What I've written here is pretty darn close and works, has worked every time when I've given this to my clients to get during a request for documents period. I'm not going to go through the whole thing, but you have copies of all construction contract documents, all construction plans and drawings that include all addendums, additions, deletions, corrections, blah, 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 up through the final acceptance. That's very important. A complete copy of the construction specifications in addition to the applicable edition of the standard spec at that time. Moving on, copies of any and all contracts between the DOT and any and all engineering design firms. This is quite extensive, very inside baseball. Copies of any and all contracts between the DOT and any and all contractors that may or may not have bid on the job. Sometimes that's important too. And in any entity, letters, emails, print, text messages, or other means of communication. Inspections, all photographs, taken, you know, progress photographs, chemically or digitally, or any other means, whatever that means, but it's, I found that to be important. Names of all the inspectors, either working for the DOT or on behalf of the DOT, or your contractor, or that work for your contractors, either work directly for the contractor or on behalf of the contractor. It depends on who your player is. Names of all inspectors with any party known, copies of any daily, weekly, monthly notebooks, journals, or workbooks. You'd be surprised. Somebody says, oh, you wanted my diary. You didn't ask for my notebook. Please. Copies of any diaries and anything like that that was used and was helped to determine the final acceptance of a particular project. Here's something you don't see asked for a lot, a copy of the project design data book, the PDD. This is something put together by the engineer that shows what traffic counts were used, the design speed of the roadway, the drainage parameters. Was it a 20-year storm? Was it a 50-year storm? What were the passing site distances, you know, based on the speed? That, you know, all these things, all these design parameters that's used by the engineer to design the roadway. Case number five. This is probably one of the most tragic incidents I've worked on. Too many teenagers, not enough seatbelts. Two carloads of teenagers. Two SUVs, two, and they were full of teenagers. They go to a park, like a Six Flags or something like that. Well, one of the cars leaves because somebody has to go home and leaves without taking anybody home. So now you have 12 teenagers who pile into an 8-passenger SUV. It has been raining inside. As you can imagine, everybody's hot and sweaty. There's loud music. The fog windshield distracts the teenage driver. Okay? The SUV leaves a newly constructed road. It rolls over, and four unbelted teenagers, there was only room for eight seatbelts, were killed, and the parents sued the contractor. Now, the contractor's insurance company, they hire me, and I work for the attorney, actually working for the attorney hired by the insurance company, to ask me to look at this road, and from all indications, the road, there was, you know, less than a 2-inch drop-off. The shoulder, everything drained properly. Everything was right. She lost control of the vehicle. It was foggy. And based on my findings, all the lawsuits were settled. It was still a tragic case, one I remind my daughters of often. The initial inspection is probably one of the most important times right after an incident. It reveals the condition of the road. And what is the suspected cause of the incident? Was the condition created by your insured? And if not, is subrogation a possibility? Which player or players could you be thinking about subrogation? Only a proper examination and testing can determine this answer. Now, don't get me wrong. It is my experience that most legal and insurance professionals, while they do not understand the importance of having a roadway engineer investigate a roadway immediately after it occurs, they try to rely on investigators, who may have been former law enforcement. These people are great at gathering big picture evidence. Where are the gouge marks? Where did the car left the road? Those type of things. A lot of the physics used by these investigators, I've been to Northwestern, their traffic institute, and what I saw that they tried to qualify as using skid marks to determine speed. It's not physics. They try to tell you it's based on it, but there are so many other things that must be taken into consideration. However, and I say they likely have never designed a road. These investigators, so they have very few clues as to what to look for with regards to a defect They will not recognize a design defect in the design or the construction of the roadway. Also, I've had cases where the roadway owners, they've been known to replace the pavements within weeks and have changed the signage. They've cut the foliage back. Maybe it was a sight distance issue. Or do other things immediately after a major roadway incident occurred. So time is of the essence. And what's a few thousand dollars for an engineer to immediately look at the roadway incident when your client may be on the hook for millions? These cases, you know, if there are significant injuries involved, you know we're talking about millions of dollars in long-term care. Now, this is the bonus material. If you have questions about the roadway stuff, keep that in mind. Go ahead and, I guess, sign in or do that, however that works. But what I want to talk about is engineering report provenance. And so here we look at the definition of the word provenance. And I look at the last two bullet points, a record of ownership of a work of art or antique used as a guide to authenticity or quality, and the last bullet point, origin. What is what engineering report origin? Now, here's the scenario. You just hired a licensed professional engineer, PE, an employee of a national forensic engineering company to investigate your claimer case. You receive the engineering report along with the $5,000 plus invoice. Now I ask you, given the recent revelations regarding changed engineering reports, I'm sure many of you saw the 60 Minutes thing where the two firms were caught changing reports regarding Hurricane Sandy. Are you sure the opinions in your report are those of your PE, or had they been changed by an administrative functionary? The answer is it depends whether or not the PE was the one who sent you the report. There is a disturbing trend. In the beginning, when I started this type of work back in 1993, it was understood, it was a practice that the PE who was hired by the client, the PE who performed the on-site inspection, the PE who called the client to discuss the findings, was the PE asked to write the engineering report and send it directly to the client. That makes sense. In the past 20 years or so, there have been the creation of several national forensic firms. I personally know of five national forensic engineering firms, good firms, many of them are, who have had their PEs submit their engineering reports to the administrative functionaries of the company. Of those five, two of them have been caught changing the PE's report in favor of the insurance company. So two out of five, that is not a good statistic. Here the ifs. If the PEs are required by law to protect life and property, and we are required by law to protect life and property, very few professions are. If the PE is bound by the ethical rules of the National Society of Professional Engineers, judges use those ethical rules. If true forensic PEs are knowledgeable of the National Society NSPE ethics and those of the National Academy of Forensic Engineers, how can PE engineering reports get changed? How could this happen? Here's the answer. In my opinion, administrative functionaries at national forensic engineering firms believe that they should have control over the content of a PE's work product. Administrative functionaries are ignorant of or ignore the fact that a PE is bound by professional engineering laws, ethics, codes, and standards. There are no long-term personal or professional consequences for administrative functionaries when they change the opinions of a PE to an opinion that the administrative functionary thinks will suit the client. The administrative functionary may get fired, but there is no license to lose. They could just go on being an administrative functionary at another national forensic engineering firm. So, how do you, the insurance or legal professional, reverse this disturbing trend and make sure you get a true and correct engineering report? It's easy. You must change the trend. You must insist, you must require, you must demand that the engineering report you receive comes from the PE that performed the investigation who wrote the report. How silly is that? That makes all kinds of sense. I know it does. Only you, insurance and legal professional, i.e., you are the marketplace, can reverse this trend of changing engineering reports after it leaves an engineer's hands. You can make sure that the eyes of the last person who saw the engineering report before you those eyes were those of the PE who wrote it. Any questions?
And could all the attendees please type the passcode into the Q&A once again? First question is, in a construction project in a major intersection, does the MUTCD require traffic lights? And if so, are pedestrians walk, don't walk signs also required for safety of workers?
The engineer that designed that intersection is the one who determines that. Whether the intersection, one, needs a light or a sign depends on traffic counts the traffic counts, just how busy is that intersection? Is it backing up traffic having a sign there? Maybe it does need a light, and the engineer decides that. Also, the engineer decides about where to place the walkways and stop and start signage for pedestrians. And they also are in charge of the timing of those things. The design engineer, bottom line, is the design engineer that designs those things, decides those things.
Okay, and in your suits, does the plaintiff sue the state, county, city involved, or does the insurance carrier third party sue the owner of that street or highway? And do you ever testify for the defense?
I missed the first couple of words of that question. Could you ask it again?
Sure. In the suits, does the plaintiff sue the state, county, city involved, or does the insurance carrier third party sue the owner of that street or highway?
That's a legal question that's for lawyers to decide. Now I can show them who the players are and who's involved here, who's had some input in a particular suit, and how they get brought in as third parties. That's really up to the lawyers. Now, I've worked both plaintiff and defense cases. The one with the teenagers, that was a defense case where I worked for the insurance company for the contractor that was being sued because of those teenagers that were killed on a properly constructed road. Next question.
Can the FHWA be held responsible for damages in a construction defect case?
Again, it depends just how much involvement was there. Generally no, because they're so far removed. That's usually done at the state level. The Federal Highway Administration, FHWA, they provide guidance as far as design codes and standards, and they have input into quality control, quality assurance, but it's rare that they are actually involved in the design of something where they could be brought into a suit. It could happen, but it's rare.
Okay, and do most state or local governments have some sort of design immunity protecting them from the liability if they approve a highway design that later turns out to be inherently dangerous?
They try. I've seen in Georgia, they always claim immunity. But then again, once it's shown that they violated – I had this one case where they violated their own code. They violated their own standard. And in that particular case, it didn't go to court. As most lawsuits, they rarely go to court. But in that particular case, I gave the DOT a copy of a letter from the Federal Highway Administration outlining how that state DOT violated their own codes and standards. That's what kept them in the case. That's why it settled.
Okay, the next question is, what documents should we look for to determine liability if a construction worker is hit by a car within the construction zone, but the car had a green light?
There were about 7-8 slides of that. Not to be flippant, but there is so much. You need all the players, and I hate saying it this way. It's almost the shotgun approach because there are so many players in a roadway construction project that nobody gets cut loose until I say so. Or at least the lawyer I'm working for says so, and he relies on me to look at just how culpable a particular party was, whether it be somebody getting hurt the way you just asked, or any type of incident.
Do GCs have a duty to speak up if the plans and specs for a roadway or intersection doesn't make sense or creates a dangerous condition, or are they generally insulated from liability where they follow the design?
What was the first part of the question?
Do GCs have a duty to speak up if the plans and specs for a roadway or intersection don't make sense or create a dangerous condition?
Yes. That's where the pre-construction, usually there's a, like I say, there's a pre-bid meeting. There's all kinds of opportunities for a contractor to, if they see something wrong, there's all kinds of opportunity. Now, do they have a duty? Well, in my opinion, they have superior knowledge. It's not their first rodeo. If they see something, they see a stop sign being placed 30 feet away from an intersection, yeah, that's something that the contractor should know or should have known that that's a problem. But there are many opportunities for a contractor to point out to the design engineer that something just doesn't make sense. It happened to me a lot. A drainage issue that just doesn't seem to work, that the contractor, he may have a suggestion on how to fix it. Well, that's where we work together. And those are things brought up in the pre-bid meeting and after the contractor is selected in the pre-construction meeting. Because many times the contractor wants to bring these things up because it means more money to be made.
Okay, those are all the questions that we have time for. If you don't mind, Richard, we could send the remaining questions over to you to be answered after the webinar is over.
That would be fine. And Emily, you'll tell me how that will happen here in a few minutes, I'm sure.
Yes, I will.
Okay,
In addition to being your best source for testifying and consulting experts, TASA also offers e-discovery and forensic solutions, free interactive webinars, and cybersecurity, and research reports on expert witnesses, such as the Challenge History Report 2.0, the Professional Sanction Search, and the Expert Profile 360. I want to take this opportunity to thank everyone for attending, and most especially Richard Rice for his time and effort in creating this presentation. If you would like to speak with Mr. Rice, or if you would like to speak with a TASA representative regarding an expert witness for a case that you are working on, please contact TASA at 1-800-523-2319. Thank you all again for attending, and have a great day, everyone. This concludes our program for today.
Thank you.